starts to catch you. Here we go. You know that half of success is just showing up. And you have to realize this. We all do. No matter how we feel, we have to show up. We have to show up at practice. We have to show up at working work. We have to show up and give some effort. And this is what is successful ultimately. If we just waited until we felt optimal, we might never show up at all. Because how often do we feel optimal here? So the opportunity is here for me. I say, okay, I don't feel especially inspired, but let's get started and see what happens. Here's a big secret. Just show up and start trying. That's it. Okay. Now the first thing to do is to just get your poise, feel some poise at full stop in the wow. We're getting ready. We realize we're going to go into some pretty amazing clarifications. First of which might be, it's very possible that we are aware of pure spaciousness, the sameness, the vision of sameness, and yet we're paying attention to our commentary upon it. Okay, we're paying attention to our commentary. So let us look at this, well, right brain, left brain. We can use that as just a convention of speech here to make it simple. Let's say extreme right-mindedness, or I don't know if it's which hemisphere, but extreme right-mindedness is vision of oneness, vision of pure spaciousness, vision of sameness, and then left brainness, so to speak, is commentary upon it. So what we do is we pay undue attention to the commentary upon it. And this is what trips us up. So we're going to look at this. And is there a way to extricate ourselves from this problem, really? It's a terrible problem we have, and I believe there is a way that we can talk about here, which is maybe more clear than we've ever heard before. The desire to be greater than God, the desire to find a flaw with reality, I say this is the very root of our troubles. And this aspect of mind that we're using of commentary upon pure spaciousness is really, it's more than commentary. So let's look at what's really going on when we ask questions, if we saw it, why would we need to ask questions? We'd say, oh, it's obviously, I'm aware of it. There's no need for any question. It's flawless. It's seamless. It's there's no doubt about it. And yet we're full of doubts. At least some aspect of our mental functioning is full of doubts. So what is that mental functioning about? And I say that it's actually about trying to find a flaw with reality. And so obviously, if that's the purpose, it's not. It's going to, when looking at pure spaciousness, like let's say, call it seamlessness. There's this vast seamless carpet, let's say. So it's looking, say, okay, so where's the seam in this? Where's the seam? I'm not seeing the seam here. You know, you may be having a vision of oneness, and this aspect of the functioning of the mind is saying, wow, okay, I'm having a hard time here finding that seam. I'm feeling kind of nervous and jittery. You know, where is the seam in this carpet? It's sort of hiding here. You know, it's hiding itself. I need some help. Can you give me some help? Help, help. I need some help here. I'm having trouble. and this is what's going on. And we say, oh, what's the problem? Well, I just, you know, I'm really upset and having trouble. I'm experiencing a great deal of difficulty and stress and strain. And I can't find the seam, you know, in this carpet. It's got to be somewhere. I know it's somewhere. So this might be the inner dialogue that we're having, or the inner talk that we're having. This is, okay, so how can you just abide in seamlessness with this chatter going on is the question. And pay no attention to it. Pay no attention to it. This is what we're trying to get to. I would submit that shifting our perception to seamlessness is not difficult. This actual shift is easy. It's abiding in it that's difficult. Because of this chatter that goes on. So already I'm feeling this resistance, like, wow, you know, this is getting very close to fruition here. If we take as a theory, you know, that we're trying to find a flaw in perfection in order to feel greater than perfection, we think if we find a flaw, that we will then say, ah, you know, we're the first ones. The prime flaw finders, and then we can work to transcend that flaw, and then we can certainly say, well, we're definitely better than reality, because reality's flawed, it doesn't even know it has a flaw, we found the flaw, we're working to fix it or transcend it, we're greater than reality. So we have this desire to find a flaw with reality. This is what is causing us the problem. That we have, and the problem of abiding in seamlessness, in sameness, seamlessness, seeing spaciousness as part of the totality. You know, it's not separate from appearances. What we're doing right now is we're separating appearances and spaciousness as if they were not some unified field. So we're not having a perception of a unified field. We're saying there are appearances in space, so to speak, but we don't realize the seamless unity of it all. Actually, we're not. But I would submit that we are. That awareness is within us, but we are have our attention on the search for what? For a flaw. For a non-unified field, okay, and so by putting it in this conceptual container, you know, it starts to make it much easier for us, and we have to somehow, you know, make it easier so we can shift our attention. The shift in perception is a shift of attention. Actually, we shift our attention off of the search onto the unified field, the absolute. Unified field where appearances and pure spaciousness are not something separate from one another. It's all one. It's all one. And when we do shift our attention, we recognize, oh wow, you know, wow. So this is, you know, this is I could have been, I said this has been here all along. Actually, this is the response we have. This has always been here. What have I been doing? You know, what? How I've been wasting my time. Because we've had our attention on the search for a flaw. So what we must do, it seems, is to recognize that this whole search for a flaw is not something that some mission that God has given us, that some imperative mission. It's a whim that we had. It is a silly whim, an idle wish. Jesus says it's an idle wish. A complete waste, meaningless. Searching for a flaw in reality. We want to be greater than God. This is just a whim on our part. And this is where the search is coming from. It is not coming from the unified field. It's not coming from God. God didn't say go search for a flaw in reality. So there isn't any mandate that we keep searching for a flaw. It's not something to feel guilty about. We say, well, I can't find a flaw. This is terrible. No, it's not terrible at all. So this is the scales that we're working on. We're trying to tip the scales, okay, in the favor of shifting our attention to the unified field and then abiding in it. And you know, so far I've not succeeded yet, but it could be close, right? The tipping of the scales could be close. We're certainly getting into this very, seems like very fruitful looking at it. What we're doing here is we're looking together, we're walking together in the wow as we look at the basis for our trouble. Now, of course, you've heard the famous call off the search. That was Punjaji and many others have said that. Call off the search. Drop the search. You don't need to keep searching for a flaw. But we feel that's like super important. What we feel like is that the flaw is there, just we can't see it. And to call off the search to find the flaw is some kind of failure on our part, like laziness on our part. And we educate ourselves to vilify and demonize this call off the searchness. You might even say this takeover of this planet by cosmic corporate culture is a takeover of this ideology of saying that, you know, you must find the flaw. It's there. And you don't dare be lazy and give up. You're gonna find it. We'll help you. We got all these gadgets and computers and stuff, and we'll put those all to work, and we're gonna find this flaw. It's there. This is the ideology. It's the flaw is there, we just have to find it. Now, this is a false ideology. The flaw is not there, actually. So again, this is the scales. You know, we're trying to get the scale to tip in the right direction. Keep weighting it with our efforts. Our efforts can be seen as like putting a coin on a scale, and we keep putting coins on it, and we're just trying to, you know, tip the balance so our attention goes, oh, yeah, seeing the unified field is. That's what I'm supposed to be doing. That's where I'm at. That's where reality is at. There isn't any flaw. So trying to find an imaginary flaw can only be seen as whimsicality, for sure. Sounds like cosmic corporate culture there. They're all on the bus, the short bus to... Everybody's saying, yeah, we're really geared up for the search. We're really searching. You know, we're awesome. We're awesome searchers. Awesome searchers. And how dare anybody talk about giving up the search? That's just despicable. Yeah, that's they feel. It's like absolutely despicable. That anything that has to do, you know, it even remotely talks about the divine, about God, about prayer, about trying to, you know, drop our sin. You know, what's our sin? Our sin is searching for a flaw in reality. That's our sin. That's why we're not aware of reality. Our attention is on the search. Very simple, isn't it? Shift our attention onto off the search, and it's on the unified field of sameness and the sameness of spaciousness and appearance. The sameness of spaciousness and appearance. And, you know, oh, so that's my home. It's always been my home. It's always been here. What have I been doing? I, of course, I know I've wasted my life. I'm aware of that because the times that I have shifted off of the search, I'm aware. And oh my gosh, this is what I'm missing. It's here all along. And we're simply just not paying any attention to it. We have our attention on this mythical search for a flaw. And all of the ruminations that are of mental activity that we use to generate this feeling like we're finding it, we're getting close, you know, it's probably over here, you know, in a general sense of we're not going to be tricked by reality, we know the flaws there, we're not going to be deceived, you know, we're not going to, so it's a funny thing, when we're engaged in the search, we think that reality is the deceiver. We think that reality is the great deceiver and that we need to not be fooled or tricked by it. We say we know there's a flaw, but somehow we're not finding it because this devious, tricky reality is deceiving us. This So we have it upside down and backwards, really. All right, little break here. Full stop in the wow. Which is what? Sort of a blend of trepidation and elation, right? It's unique. It's unique. It's a unique feeling. This is why I say, when you feel this wow, when you're able to recognize, this feeling, what is this feeling I have? Am I stuck? No. It's wow. It's a feeling of trepidation and elation, which can feel like you're stuck. Okay, it can feel like, I really can't search right now, you know? It's like, oh my gosh, that's okay. we don't need to search. Don't need to search. One moment. Okay. All right. Wow. Stay in the wow. You feel like, I'm not searching. Is that okay? It's okay that I'm not searching? Oh my gosh, could I dare do this? You know, my gosh, I just let my mind just kind of sit in neutral like this? So, part trepidation and part elation. Trepidation, elation. You're kind of worried like there's some taboo. I'm not searching. What's the matter with me? And elation is saying, yeah, it's great. I'm not searching. That's wonderful. So if we feel, when you feel stuck, when you just feel blah, I'm stuck, you say, what's the matter with me? I want enlightenment, but I just feel like I don't care, I'm just stuck. Realize that's the wow. You're not recognizing the wowness of it. You're actually in the wow. You need to be conscious. Oh, full stop in the wow. Let me be conscious that, okay, of that. And then tell yourself, oh, now I'm practicing. I'm consciously practicing the threefold practice. And this will get you unstuck because you're recognizing what's going on. You say, okay, now what is it that's causing the trepidation? Let's work on the trepidation a little bit. So that's called flipping the script. Let's work on flipping the script a little bit, which is how we started out this video, is working on flipping the script. So be aware you're always on the path. You're never off the path. You're always on it. This is the key to success. The people in this world, they're comatose. They're not aware they're on the path. As soon as you become aware of your path, then you say, oh my gosh, yeah, I do have the tools. I am on the path. I am in full stop in the wow. I'm just feeling this wowness, sort of trepidation, elation. I feel just, you know, like that. I'm sort of stopped. I'm stuck. Then you start go to work flipping the script. Sort of ease the trepidation part of it. Ease that. Ease the continuity fear of the elation. Ease the trepidation. And then you go back to some assertions when you feel really particularly confident. I already know. Yes, I've already called off the search, okay? I already know that I've already called off the search. I already know that I've already called off the search. I already know that I'm already enlightened. I already know that I'm already enlightened. I already know I've already called off the search. I already know that reality has no flaw. I already know that reality has no flaw. So these are the three parts of the path. Assertion, full stop on the wow, flipping the script. And you can always do one of those. Okay, so your practice can be pretty much seamless. Not that it has to be seamless, but you can keep it going. Keep it going. You don't quit. You don't feel like, I have no idea what I'm doing. Oh, of course we do. If you say, I don't have any idea what I'm doing, that, then you're in the wow. The feeling of wow has kind of overwhelmed you, and you kind of lost focus on it. And you need to start, bring yourself back to that, and then work on flipping the script, which is what we started the video on, saying, hey, now, wait a minute now. Maybe this is how it happened. I was thinking in before this video, I was thinking, now, wait a minute, maybe, you know, why do we not abide in the vision of oneness? What's going on? Maybe it's just all this commentary of talking about the flaw. Now, some of this commentary acts like there is a flaw, even though it doesn't see it. It uses a type of spiritual practice. So let us look at it this way. It's as if our search in itself is a kind of anti-spiritual practice by saying, I know I've already found the flaw. Okay, so it really can act in that way, where it's like commenting on the flaw that it sees, and saying, "Wow, you know, look at that flaw that's in it," you know, and so that kind of intimidates us. We say, "Well, wait, what flaw? You found the flaw?" No, it's actually engaging in a sort of reverse meditation, upside down, backwards, anti-meditation, anti-truth. Anti-assertion, saying, oh yes, I already know, I've already found the flaw. So this is how we keep ourselves going. It's kind of like dark meditation on ignorance, meditation on darkness, a way of maintaining our ignorance and darkness, maintaining our search, is we're using these mental practices actually. So what we do is they're very powerful practices. They're powerful enough to hold our attention, you see. So they're attention getters. They say, oh my God, I know I've already found the flaw. You know, and the attention goes, oh, where, really, you found the flaw? Well, yes, I already know, I've already found it. And our attention goes there. So what we need to do is to say, hey, I already know that there isn't any flaw. I know I've already found out that there already isn't any flaw whatsoever. And I already know that there isn't any finding of any flaw. Yes, I already know there is no finding of any flaw. Yes, I already know I've already given up the search to find what doesn't exist. Yes, I already know. So we're countering the mental practices that actually are going on all the time. And we're not even aware of it. Our searching and believing there's a flaw are actually just mental practices that we're engaged in. And sometimes we get tired of those practices for just a moment, and we kind of maybe stop, and that's when we become aware, oh my gosh, it's all one. The spaciousness and appearance and everything is all a unified whole. We see that. And then quickly we're back to the practice. Like, I already know the flaw in this unified whole. Yeah, I'm already seeing it. And we go, what? Really? Oh, wow. Okay. And we start paying attention to that again. So this is what? Flipping the script. See how we've worked on flipping the script here? We've now gotten to the point where we realize our mind has actually been engaged in all these powerful yogic meditational techniques to claim our attention, to pull our attention into the search and the commentary on the so-called flaw of how successful our search has been, why it was so successful, the flaw that we found and the commentary upon the flaw, or the continued search of saying that we've narrowed it down to, you know, it has to be within these parameters. And so our attention gets pulled into that. If we say we're absolutely sure that we already know that the flaw is somewhere within this parameter, for instance, somewhere within this planet, we know the flaw is here somewhere on this planet. We've narrowed it down. We've searched the whole universe. We finally realize the flaw is here on this planet. And the God of the search has blessed our mission here, telling us, yes, you're correct. You're right. This is the center of the search right here. Center of the universal search for the flaw. And we've narrowed it down. And so, of course, our attention then is, oh my gosh, you've narrowed it down that much? Wow, you must be getting close to finding it then. So we're using these very clever mental techniques to deceive ourselves, to pull our attention off of just looking the natural awareness of the complete unified field of all there is. The effortlessly unified, it's not stitched together, it is this unified field where our attention is just onto the search for a flaw in the unified field. So what we've done is we've dug a little deeper now, haven't we? And so there's some wow arising, a bit of trepidation, a bit of elation, for sure. There's some elation here because this is a great clarification of what's going on in our mind, actually. We think there's just all these random thoughts. No, I would say there's some very powerful mental activity specifically designed to pull our attention onto the search. It's very much like a continual meditation, actually. So we're continually meditating on the search. So no wonder why our attention keeps getting chased back there. You know, it suddenly our mind screams, oh my gosh, we've narrowed it down even further. You know, and that's why we're here. What the mind tells us is the reason why we're here with this body in this world is we've done a massive amount of work and we finally narrowed it down, you know, to this world. And the body is that which is capable of locating the flaw. See, our bodies are the flaw finders. And we think we're like totally blessed. We think the God of the search has blessed us with these bodies. And these bodies are going to enable us to find the flaw. And we're here in the world where we've realized this is where the flaw is. And we're going to be able to finally find it. And then when we finally find it, the God of the search tells us, we will be transcendent of reality, actually. We'll transcend the flaw by finding it. So, of course, this part of our mind, we're thinking, wow, this is really, what a great opportunity here to be in this world with the body, be able to finally recognize the flaw and find it. And by finding it, we will receive some sort of transcendent boost where we'll now be greater than God. The God of the search even tells us, you're going to be even greater than me, you know, greater than me. Because once you find it, you know, you're obviously greater than the search. I'm just the God of the search, but you're going to actually find it. And that'll make you greater than me. So, wow, we're seeing how we've been deceiving ourselves, haven't we? It's the book, you know, is now an open book. This is, you know, when the book is closed, you don't know what's in there. Open the book and you look, oh, and once you open the book, you know what's inside the book. So this is hitting hard. I mean, I had no idea I was going to get into this. That's why I say just try. And this is such a recognition, powerful recognition. What we do when a real powerful recognition comes, what you do is you intentionally put the brakes on. Even if you think you don't need to. Just say, okay, we're just going to take a little break right here. Because the ramifications of this, it's enormous. It's just as if, you know, so I don't even want to chase the ramifications down. Don't try to chase the ramifications down, because then you might get all kind of frantic about it. So don't get frantic when you're in your spiritual practice. Don't get frantic. Don't get hyped up. Don't get frantic. Obviously, this is just a extraordinary recognition here. The God of the search. I mean, this is what this is. I mean, just seeing it, say, oh my gosh, this is what's been going on. The God of the search telling us that we'll be greater than the God of the search once we find the flaw. Holy cow. And so we let the bell just ring, you know, let the bell ring. and don't go running all over the place. Can we hear the bell here? Can we hear the bell there? It's like there's this huge bell that's just been gonged, you know, so strongly. And the bell is just ringing and reverberating. Well, we know that this reverberation is traveling in 360 degrees, don't we? So we don't need to go running around. Do I hear it over here? Do I hear it over there? Over there? You'd be smart. We'd say, of course it's being heard over there. Of course it's reverberating throughout our entire being. But we don't need to frantically go running all over the place. Just sit still. Now, all of the advice on the path bears repeating over and over and over again. Because the constant activity of the search and the tricks we use keeps pulling our attention onto the search. And we keep feeling we get dull again. We lose the sharpness. And so it's worth repeating over and over again. That's why sometimes the spiritual path turns into rituals, which turn into what we call religion. That can become a stale in itself. Okay. So it bears repeating, but it may not necessarily have to be put into a ritual. See, this is interesting. Because the repetition is more like it becomes important in the context of the wow, rather than just as a ritual. You cannot produce the wow merely through a ritual. This is what I found out, for instance, in attending Mass, Roman Catholic Mass. The ritual, there's a lot of stuff there which is appropriate in the context, though, of rapid spiritual progress and the wowness of it. But you cannot simulate the spiritual path merely through ritual. That doesn't work. In other words, the advice is really only taken to heart when the bell is ringing. I mean, when the bell is really ringing like this, then you say, hey, don't run around, you know, and try to find out, you chase around and see if you heard here, 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 here. Then you say, oh, I get it. Yeah, that's great advice. But if there's no bell ringing, you know, it's stale, isn't it? It's pretty stale. So to merely codify advice and put it into rituals and have a formalized religion like this is not the way to go, actually. The way to go is for each one of us to actually be putting in the effort every day to go further into clarity. We had the merry pranksters here in the 1960s with their bus, and they had on it further, you know, and it was this Ken Kesey and the merry pranksters, but they should have put on, you know, franticness maybe. I mean, the further going further rings the bell, and then when the bell is rung, you sit quietly. And you don't frantically go searching. Well, how about, is the bell ringing here and ringing over there and ringing there? You know, we all use your intelligence, your reason. Say, wait, it must be ringing, reverberating through my entire being. I don't need to go catalog or track it down. I think that bus eventually ended up on Ken Kesey's farm. What was it, up in Washington or Eastern Washington or Oregon or somewhere, you know, in the Northwest there, resting out. people are trying to find a way, and they still are, to experience this unified field within the corporate context of going, of searching. They were trying to unify the already inherently unified field. Unified, let's be careful here. Unified doesn't mean that anything has been put together. It means that it's inherently inseparable. So the inherently inseparable oneness of reality, they're trying to unify that with the flaw, you know, seeing a flaw in it. So it's both flawed and not flawed kind of thing. Well, how do we get quick enlightenment, you know, on a Sunday afternoon and then go back to work on Monday? And so they were using drugs, psychedelics for that. And they used meditation, but psychedelic, used drugs and meditation. So what they wanted to do was you know, get in a jacuzzi or something on a weekend and experience this unified field. Wow, you know, and then again on Monday, go out there and earn $1 million, you know. Jump back into the searching mode. Kind of do it both. You know, instant enlightenment. And you can understand, because the stranglehold that the corporate culture had on us then, back in the, you know, in the 50s, after basically, you know, World War II, leading up to World War II, and then after World War II, the military-industrial complex, you know, it was just amazing that the marketing of the industries that basically said, you are now officially consumer cows, and you all work for the, you know, USA Incorporated, and we are the global superpower, and you know, you are part of the machinery of bringing peace to and prosperity to the whole world, and everybody felt, you know, this is what we're supposed to do, and you're supposed to have, you know, 4 children in a suburban home and all this kind of stuff. And then people are saying, hey, wait a minute, how do we break free of that? So they said, well, we can only do it in just like surreptitiously, you know. So the drugs became very popular. But ultimately, I think the lesson we learned from the 60s is that drugs are not it. Doesn't work. So it's pretty funny. I mean, the 60s is really the baby. I mean, the baby boom generation, you know, did this great effort and service to the world, and that should be that drugs are not it. That sex, drugs, and rock and roll, that's not it. Doesn't work. And I think something that really bothers our generation, baby boomers, I'm right on the end of it, cusp of it, so to speak. Where I actually learned from the failure of the early baby boomers. I mean, so it's like I was in an ideal situation, really, where I could judge and look at all the effort the baby boomers had done, and I was still barely part of that. And then I could say, no, wait a minute, okay, what's really going on, without getting too wrapped up into it. So it's an ideal observational viewpoint that when I was born in 1956. The younger generation isn't paying any attention to what the boomers have, to the wisdom they have, really. And I know that this hurts the boomers quite a bit. They're saying, why, you know, why can't you learn from what we learned? Very important. And maybe it's because they haven't been able to articulate it properly. Because they, you know, from whatever reason, but it's being articulated properly here, from how I see it, as I was put in an ideal position to be able to, you know, recognize the bigger picture of what's going on, and finally, you know, clarify it. It's like, wow, okay, you don't succeed in that way. You become a drug addict, you basically, is what happens. Or you give up the path. You know, both bad options. You don't ever get sensitive to the path, the three faces, the assertions. Some UPS driver just walked up the path here. Just a second here. Didn't even see me. Wasn't even aware of me. Wow. He walked right past me, put a parcel on the front porch. You're not supposed to put it there. I don't know. He must be new. Wrong door. And then walked right past me. Again, never saw me. Interesting. Attention, huh? Like I said, I'm invisible. Truth is invisible here. It's an orphan. It's an invisible orphan in this world. Holy cow. Well, I was ready. I just, you know, I'm just like got the mouse here and I'm just, you know, surfing the surfing the web. The door is just open. Just one moment. Is just closed. Great opportunities to practice the wow, isn't it? Trepidation, elation. Just sit there and say, okay, I'm making great progress. The bell is rung. Don't let me run around. It's a very easy way to think of full stop in the wow. This big bell has just been rung very strongly, and you're not running around all over town to see, can I hear it here? Imagine some big bell tower in a European medieval town, and it gets rung very strongly, and you say, oh, gosh, let me go down the street here and see if I can hear it. Oh, let me run over in the field over there, and let me go up behind this bell over here on the mountaintop, and, oh, can I hear it there? Can I? No, you just sit in the plaza there, and just sit there and say, I know the bell's being heard all over. Is reverberating equal 360 degrees. It's no, this is, so I'm just going to keep sitting here. Full stop in the wow. Full stop. Don't be running anywhere. How was I not seen there? That's pretty amazing. I can't believe that. But that shows you that those who engage in the search are not aware of what's right in front of them, right? This is a perfect example. I thought he just was being polite, but no, he was not even aware. I looked at him, he's not even aware of me whatsoever. So here we have a situation. He will say, no, there's no, I didn't see anybody, there's nobody there, what are you talking about? And if he came back and saw me, he'd probably go, oh my gosh, how did I miss that? You know, that's crazy. How did I miss that? So how is it that we're missing this unified field, this oneness, vision of oneness? How is it we're missing this? Because our attention is on the search, isn't it? That's why we're missing it. Wow. What, where are we at here now? 44 or something, probably. It always seems to be 44 when I check. I can't escape that number. Wow. So the result of spiritual practice is you get this wow, you get your bell rung, okay? You get your bell rung, and it's part trepidation, part elation. And there's really nothing you can do about it except to be patient. And when once the bell's rung, you know, you let the reverberations calm down, and gradually the bell does cool down, doesn't it? we're getting a lot of neighborly activity here, but because of this microphone, I can probably keep going. But the wow is very strong. We've loosened up a lot of knots here, actually. Again, we're not going to categorize them. We're not going to go search for them. We're not going to name them. We're not going to number them. Not going to compile anything. We're not going to go running around the town, checking out the different spots where the bell can be heard. We're just going to keep sitting quietly right where we are. Because if you go running all over the place, you'll come back all tired and frantic and say, oh, I went so many places and I heard the bell being rung. I heard the bell so many places. Yeah, that's great. But oh, I need to rest. Oh, this is too much for me. I'm so tired. And I need to, you know, take a week off or something. Whereas if you're just sitting there in the plaza quietly, after a while you say, hey, I feel like I'm going to now ring the bell again. And again, and again, and so you're the one that makes all the progress. We're not done ringing the bell here. We're saving our energy. And again, don't worry about trying to remember how we ring the bell. We're focused now on getting used to, just getting accustomed to this and make sure everything's okay. Because anything this strong is like an inner psychic earthquake, spiritual earthquake. And the landscape has changed. And we got to make sure everything's okay. And my psyche is not just the body, it's the mind. The mind saying, is my mind okay now? Is everything okay? We had a little earthquake in the Bay Area today. Every day that we have a little earthquake is fine. We just don't want the big one. Mandatory water cuts in California today. I don't know if it's 20 or 30%, but the governor finally did something. He had to have some photo op up in the Sierras where they take the snowpack measurement. And they had him up there with the scientists, and they had them walking on this meadow where they measure, I guess, and there wasn't a trace of snow anywhere. And so then they set up a microphone, and he said, hey, mandatory cuts now statewide. I think he declared a state of disaster or emergency. And finally, they're going to raise the prices based on how much water you use. Hallelujah. That's the first step. The next step is to say there's only so much water allocated per household, so to speak. I mean, people are still watering their trees and watering their shrubs. I mean, they have a complete, you know, system, watering system throughout their entire yard that just hits everything. All their trees. I mean, they're watering all their trees, for goodness sakes. Shrubs. I don't water shrubs or trees at all. That's ridiculous. They're watering their ivy. You know, no, that stuff has to get water from its roots going down, and you know, so they're just using way too much water. So anyway, here comes the boot of bureaucracy, and this is actually one good use of government, is when you have a severe drought. This is, you know, this is why we need some governance. Of course, the governance tends to, bureaucracy tends to try and perpetuate itself and find reasons to do so. So it becomes very tyrannical, dictatorial and tyrannical, which we experience very much so. And this is why America was founded, basically. People fleeing the tyranny of bureaucracy. Too many laws, too many restrictions, too many saying, this is how you have to lead your life. And they said, wow, we'll go to America, then we'll go to this new land here. And now America's become the new, you know, tyrant as far as bureaucracy goes, tyrannizing the people here. So where do we go from here is the question. But when we have a severe drought, it's been shown the people are lazy, they're used to their habits, and They don't want to cut back water. I mean, we had voluntary cutbacks for a long time now, and people didn't do it. Absolutely didn't do it. So they said, hey, got to put the heavy hand of the law upon you here, and we're going to start charging you a lot more. Of course, the richer will just pay it, you know. It's the poor and middle class and poor who can't afford to pay, so they'll have to let their yards die. The rich will just say, okay, we'll pay for whatever, however much it costs, it doesn't matter, we can pay it. But that's why I say they have to put restrictions on how much you can use. And they'll get there hopefully at some point. So we're in a drastic state of emergency in California, absolutely running out of water. But that wow can't even remotely compare to the wow that we've experienced right here in this video. This wow is just continuing on and continuing on and continuing on. I'm just like, wow. It's an attention getter. Don't be oblivious to this, just like that UPS man was oblivious to me, oblivious to what's going on here, oblivious to this taping, oblivious to this information. Don't think that oblivion is salvation. It's not. Being oblivious to reality is not salvation. And yet this is what the search is telling you. Don't worry. The idea of reality being perfect is only a myth. It's an archaic myth, a dangerous myth. This is what's being taught surreptitiously, and this is the meta message of the world's educational system, which all of these younger people now in the world have been raised heavily on this educational system and have not rejected. I mean, the 60s was all about rejecting the education we got. We said it's all corporate. Okay, it's all corporate. It's all a lie. It's all designed to control us, which is true. I even had a course in high school which was specifically on the media, where we researched and studied how the media deceives us and lies to us and is a tool of corporations. Never more so than now. You know, but everybody's too interested in how to, you know, get rich. I mean, the mainstream media is just totally corporate, and they've brainwashed people to believe that they're smart by following their narrative. that this is what is successful. This is what smart, caring, successful people do. You know, very tricky. But like I said, I was raised in the generation, and myself particularly, focused on the seed of media and advertising and corporations and how to see through that. So I've always seen through it. And actually my family was super aware of all this already. So I was raised with a super awareness of how we're manipulated and deceived and brainwashed and propagandized by powerful institutions of corporate institutions, in which politics is just an extension of that. And so these corporate lemmings are at war with religion right now, claiming that's the one that's brainwashing everybody. I mean, they're just projecting all this feeling of being brainwashed onto institutions of spiritual reorientation, is a better way to look at them, and claiming that's where the evil is, that's where the brainwashing is coming from, not being able to admit within themselves that they've been brainwashed by corporations. So it's a classic projection is taking place in the world right now. Whereas you feel guilty and wrong and bad about your own limitations, that you did something wrong, which you accepted this brainwashing, and instead of being aware of it, you say no, it's not from corporations, it's coming out there. Which of course corporations made sure that there was a scapegoat to project upon, which is exactly what they're doing. We're doing a little flipping of the script here. Okay. Corporations are very, very clever. You might call them primitively clever. not so clever. You can't see through it. It's transparent, actually. Once you recognize, you say, "Oh my gosh, this is just obvious, totally basic what they're doing." But they're relentless at it. They have all the advertising money, and the actresses, and actors, and producers, and screenwriters, and scriptwriters, and all of the entertainers, and they make it seem entertaining and glamorous and sexy, and they make it seem like that, you know, this is the good life, you know, believe in what we tell you is the good life. And those terrible spiritual institutions of spiritual orientation, they want you to live a tough, disciplined life, and that's no fun. They don't want fun. They don't want any fun. What's the matter with them? They want you to call off the search. What's the matter with them? They're crazy. They're lazy. Crazy and lazy. They're bad. They're evil. They're talking about a God that doesn't exist, you know. Meanwhile, all these people are following this God of the corporate God of the search, the God of the search. That's the one that doesn't exist, actually. So they feel guilty about this. They feel wrong. Something's wrong. They project this and saying, "Oh, I'm not brainwashed, but yet, but I feel the pressure. I feel this pressure on me. Oh, it's coming from the institutions of spiritual reorientation. They're the evil. We must destroy them. And by destroying them, I will be free of any brainwashing." So it's called the scapegoat. So the corporations brainwashed the public. They had a very convenient scapegoat. It's this institutions of spiritual orientation, especially those aspects of it that are kind of ragged and struggling and, you know, it's easy target, right, kind of thing. Easy targets. And then project it onto them, saying, "Those are the ones that are trying to brainwash you. Us, the corporations, are protecting you from being brainwashed." Classic. Classic. They did a lot of study on it, for sure. Put a lot of research money into how to brainwash society and civilization. And they've done an excellent job at it, as we see. But there's always these pesky people who can't understand the brilliance of their scapegoating, projection and scapegoating, and how that's like, they're saying, but it's so clever, you know, how don't you appreciate our cleverness? Well, we give you a little golf applause, okay, a little golf applause for that, but, you know, what more do you really want? I mean, it leads to severe suffering and severe mental problems and all that kind of stuff. So we can't give much more than a little golf a clap for the cleverness of it, you know. Just, yeah, you lag the putt up there within 6 feet and a little, okay. It's not like you sank the putt, come on. You blasted out of the bunker or something. I don't know, you hit an approach shot out of the bunker and people would say, "Oh, okay, it's they didn't shank it, you know, Lisa." But nothing to get too excited about, folks. Come on, what are you asking for the moon here? Which is another tactic they use. They ask for the, you know, they want everyone, you know, to be like rapturously, you know, worshiping and applauding them. It's like, "Oh my gosh, we're so clever. We figured out how to brainwash people by, you know, having this scapegoat and then projecting onto them, you know, and we found the scapegoat too. And this is like brilliant, brilliant." Nah, it's just kind of, you know, lazy. Just kind of stupid. It's like, "We found this great stupidity." Yeah, well, I mean, that's nothing to be too proud of, actually. It's way more brilliant to see through it and free yourself from it, right? That's where the applause is. I mean, let's get real. I mean, since we have to see through it, and since it's nothing but misery and suffering for us, it's seeing through it and extricating ourselves from this nonsense. That's where the brilliance is. But, you know, they're on a power trip. The world's on this power, egoic power trip right now, because it's glamorized this basic technique of projection and scapegoating, and feeling then that by attacking the scapegoat, that you're protecting yourself from the very problem that you already have. And it diverts your attention away from what's actually causing the problem. You see, you get a false cause. You're attacking false causation. And so when you do this little trick here, you think, wow, I'm incredibly clever here. It doesn't work. I don't know how clever, you know, I don't know how clever one can feel when what they're doing is a miserable failure. I mean, I don't know what the point is in plotting that, because you're basically plotting miserable futility. And plotting like confusion, fear, confusion, death, suffering, misery, uncertainty, depression, despair, doubt. I mean, I don't know why we're plotting that, actually. As if the applause is some even a greater, you know, icing on the cake. It's icing on the cake. Like, we're not only are we brilliant, we're applauding our brilliance. We have brilliant futility here. I'm not sure how brilliant futility is. We found a way to keep the search going. We found a way to keep futility alive. Wow. We're the brilliant mothers of futility, keeping it alive and nurturing it. The great mother is advising us how to keep alive futility and how to nurture it, and how not to fall into that terrible pit of God where we're lazy and archaic and regressive, or you give up the search and you quit even trying, and you fail in the mission you've been given. How awful is that? You know, this is the rhetoric, you know, this is the meta message that's being delivered to us constantly, actually. Constantly. That's why the Holy Spirit said you got to stay away from all of that stuff, because it's relentlessly wears you down. Stay away from the news, the entertainment, the media, all that kind of stuff. Stay away from however corporations are trying to have different ways they have to reaching you. Just be unreachable by them as much as possible. And of course, then you have the problem of feeling you're so out of step with the rest of the world that starts getting jittery, you know. So it's a fine balance. You want to at least feel like, yeah, I kind of have a little idea of what's going on, but very little. The Holy Spirit tells me if there's something that I need to know, the Holy Spirit will tell me, just take a peek at this, just a headline. Oh, it's a headline. Okay, people will be talking about this. Okay, that's it. Don't dig into it, really. Not too much. So sometimes I'll go without paying any attention to anything for months and months. And then one day the Holy Spirit says, you might want to just take a peek at this. And I say, oh, okay. People will be, you know, sort of, it becomes something that is part of, they think is something's important. What's important is what we're doing here, actually, is putting our attention where it needs to be put and looking at the very mechanism of what's distracting our attention. Become aware of this mechanism. Wow. And realizing there really is this mechanism. We really have been employing these tricks on ourselves. So becoming aware of this is very important. Excuse me. It's tremendous. It's tremendous. So we're not stuck in just some haphazard, mysterious, no way to understand situation, actually. We're actually, we're intentionally distracting our attention away from what's actually present using these tricks. And the more we see this, the more we say, I'm not going to be tricked by that anymore. So when we realize that, we say, wow, that means I can get to see the unified field, right? Yeah, we do. We do get to see it. And that's where the elation and trepidation come in. That's where the wow comes in. So by doing this, you become a meditation master, a master of meditation, really. Just by doing this, working at it, you have direct experience here. We're not just reading some book. We're actually doing it here. That's what's fun. That's what's really engaging, is actually doing it. Corporations will let you read a book, they just won't let you really engage in something like this. I mean, sure, people, that's why books sell so well, actually. These books sell so well because they'll say, the corporations will say, well, yeah, you're a spiritual being, of course, yeah, we understand that. And here, go read this book. And you read the book and say, oh, okay, this now, this and this and that. Oh, okay, cool. I'm okay, now I'm informed about it. Okay, great. It doesn't bother my search much. I understand that I need to be searching for incorporated into your search. That's great. As soon as we find the flaw, fix the flaw and everything, that we'll get this nowness, this enlightenment. That's okay, fine. So sure, you can write a book and it'll be a bestseller, but that's nothing compared to actually what we're doing here and actually meditating in this powerful, super powerful meditational way of this three-part meditation, actually. Three-part spiritual practice. This is powerful. And I know it is because I've read all the books, you know, and I realize that's not it. It's never going to get it done. Reading books is never going to get it done. You have to practice. You have to jump in the pool. You can't swim if you're not in the pool. You know, lounging around the pool, reading a book, you're never going to learn how to swim. It's like people are sitting, lounging around a pool, reading a book on how to swim, and thinking, oh, I know how to swim. Are you kidding me? I don't need to get in the pool. I know how to swim. I just read the book, How to Swim. What are you guys doing in the pool? Stupid. You know, and they still stay on the good side of their brainwashing. The search, stay on the good side of the search. Stay on the good side of the god of the search, or the goddess of the search, actually. They say both god, goddess of the search. You know, they want the god to say, I gave you the mandate to find the flaw of reality. And then the goddess is saying, and I'm nurturing your search. I'm nurturing. I'm like a mother helping you along. And you're like, you're the child. You're my child, the search child. And I'm nurturing you, mothering you, raising you up. And I'm going to help you be successful. Don't you worry. that's the spiritual matrix of people's belief system in this world, the god goddess of the search. If it's not god, it's goddess, or if it's not god or goddess, it's god goddess. You know, they switch all over the place. Sometimes it's god, sometimes it's goddess, and then they get real sophisticated. They think they're really sophisticated searchers. They'll say, it's the god goddess. That's, now I got it. They're the ones inspiring in my success in this, my successful search. And so just seeing this, it's like, oh, wow, I always knew this, but I never quite, you know, could, I was still intimidated to, you know, to say it and hear it and just recognize it like this. It's, oh my gosh, this is a big one. This is really seeing it this clearly. Just holy cow. Holy clarity. That's great. So again, the brainwashing that we've done to ourselves is to say that the reason why we feel bad is we just haven't discovered the flaw yet and fixed it yet. That's why as soon as we just find the flaw and fix it, we'll feel perfect. And then we say, and those who are telling us to give up, call off the search, we don't need a search, everything's perfect, they're crazy. They're interfering with my future happiness. Right? They're interfering with my fun, my happiness. I want the search to be fun. I want to enjoy the search. And they're causing me to feel self-conscious, causing me to feel guilty, causing me to feel sinful. And their teaching is crazy. They say it's sinful. The search is sinful. It's futile. You know, how terrible. They're ruining my life. You know, they're evil. They're bad. They must be destroyed. This is what's taking place in the world. You see it playing out on the screen of this, you know, of this dream. And of course, Jesus just came and said, "Hey, guess what? You don't have to search. There is no the God of the search, this angry, punitive God of the search, and this mother goddess of nurturing the search. You don't need those. There's just one God, and this perfect unified field of oneness, of pure spaciousness, of pure being, pure awareness, and this God is a God of absolute love, actually." Put another way, that there's no fear in this God at all. There's no attack. There's no anger. There's no fear. There's no harm. You're invulnerable, perfectly invulnerable, and you don't need to do anything. If this is already the case, you just have to put your attention on it. And people said, "What are you talking about? We thought you were here, you're the Messiah. Well, you're supposed to destroy the terrible scapegoats, those people who are making us feel bad, those people who are not, you know, helping our search. Let's get rid of them. God hates those people, you know, who are interfering with our search. The God of the search." And now the new standard carrier of the God of the search are the global corporations, the media, entertainment industry, the news, information, all of those. That's the new, that's the spokeswoman for the God of the goddess of the search. It's now become the goddess of the search, or God goddess, or goddess God. They'll twist and say it's the goddess God of the search, and then eventually it's the goddess. She's, you know, because she understands. She's the mother understands, of course, what the child really wants, and the father is saying, "No, you must discipline yourself. You must forego immediate gratification." You know, and the child's screaming, "I want immediate gratification." And the mother says, "Oh, okay, yes." Father's just too strict. He's mean. You know, mean father. And so the more indulgent we become in this world, the more bad habits we have, the less disciplined we are, the more we ignore meditation, the more we ignore, you know, working on shifting our attention off of the search, the more we just become lazy, irresponsible, searchers for futility, futilists actually. The more that those who are disciplined get demonized. Where I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. We're not supposed to have our attention on bodies, on hedonism and pleasure and fun and all this kind of stuff. All that stuff is just used to pump up the search. Saying, you know, don't worry, you'll be real thrilled with being a body living in this world. this is you know, great for you. Eat as much as you want, you know, just indulge, be indulgent. Don't worry, the goddess wants you to indulge. She's finally put her foot down and says, that God is just too strict, forget it, let's get rid of him, let's all just indulge, let's just all, you know, have these massive raves of indulgence and parades and raves, and just, you know, let's just, wallow in our importance of being bodies that we're super important, because we're going to find the flaw. We're designed to find the flaw with reality. That's why we're here. God created us, designed us to find the flaw with reality, and put us here in this world. So let us congratulate ourselves on our inevitable ultimate success, and let's start partying right now, because we know we're going to find the flaw and fix it and transcend, and then we'll be perfect and greater than God. So let's start patting ourselves on the back and celebrating and indulging in any way we possibly can right now. Or, as they did in the 60s, let's take a little vacation. Let's have both. Let's have the unified field of perfection and also the search for imperfection. And let's kind of alternate between those two and use drugs to kind of knock out one and then use stimulants to get us back into the other. I mean, let's use the weekends to just completely try to knock our self-perception off of the search, and then let's use the caffeine and energy drinks to get ourselves going again Monday to get back into the search. Well, I know a lot of people are that way. Actually, from my generation, baby boomers, they kind of, used drugs to calm down, and then to stimulants. Pep pills, caffeine, the energy drinks. They're always trying to devise all these energy drinks to get them going. And then the weekends, the alcohol, the pot, the various, ways of psychedelics and all this kind of stuff to just kind of shift, try to get their attention off the search to some extent. And that's a mess, it's a mess. Stuck in that. Don't want to get stuck in that, I'll tell you. They used to use tobacco products too. I mean, it's not used as much anymore. But tobacco, oh yeah, I mean, that's a stimulant. Absolutely. I've talked to people who used to, use tobacco, and they said, it focuses my mind. I feel engaged. I feel focused. My God, I mean, the Chinese, just about everybody, all the men, at least the men there. I don't know about the women, probably the women too. I don't know for sure, but I mean, almost everyone, Chinese, smoke, chain smokers, because it they feel constantly focused and go. It's a very strong stimulant. And their culture right now reflects that, actually. Go. We're the kings of the search, lords of the search. Look how focused we are. Look how relentless we are. We're the icons of the search now. We're the new standard bearers of the search, which, if you think that's what the purpose is here, then you could say that, because the USA is not quite as folk-driven as before, because everybody stopped smoking here. I mean, they're pounding the energy drinks to compensate for it. It used to be cigarettes and coffee, of course. Now it's more like energy drinks. And actually, cocaine was used extensively. I mean, the Silicon Valley was basically candy bars and cocaine and caffeine. That's what Silicon Valley was all about. That's what drove. That's why they're so relentlessly focused on search. So it developed all these search engines. You see, the search engine-ness. And ability to search, and gadgets to enhance your searching. The people who are involved with that, I'm telling you, I came across them. Guys sitting in a dark room, and it's just candy wrappers. I mean, a case of Snickers bars, and just drinking coffee nonstop. And then, of course, they got their line of cocaine there, and this is what they did. They never see the sun, pasty white, or pasty whatever. They're pasty, let's put a pasty. And coding, you know, inventing, getting this, we got to get this, you know, we're here to enhance your search. We're here to convince you that the search, you can succeed at the search. I'm a fourth dimensional. I'm a cosmic corporate cultist. I'm a cosmic corporate culture cultist. Nice to meet you. We're here to enhance your search experience and actually give you the tools you need to succeed at your search. And we're very happy to be here, and I know you're glad to have us here, and we're gonna make everything wonderful for you. Don't worry. I mean, I saw a couple days ago this CEO type coming out of a driveway. I mean, you could tell where he lived and the car he's driving. You know, he's, you know, some big honcho somewhere, of course. They're all big honchos around here, basically. But, and so he comes, I see him, you know, going to work in the morning. He comes out at the end of his driveway and there's this busy highway, you know, and he has to get onto. And like, he didn't want to stop. He was so amped up, he didn't want to even stop. And there's cars coming. I said, "Holy cow! I think he's going to pull right out right in front of the, right in front of me." Actually, I was coming along, and he didn't want to stop. He says, "I'm ready to go. I'm not stopping for anything." That's how amped up he was. And finally, he stopped. I almost had an accident. You know, he just was going to pull right out. And so then he finally pulls out behind me. You know, we had to go slow because there's a speed limit there. Well, he didn't want to go the speed limit. He was really upset. I could tell he was right tailgating, like, you know, get out of my way. And finally, the highway went into two lanes. And the speed limit picked up. So I picked it up. I need to turn off, so I wasn't going that fast. And he just zoomed around me. He just, wow! You could tell he's just like, how dare I be slowed down? This is the mentality that get up in the morning and says, no, nothing's going to slow me down. I'm here to break all barriers. I'm here to speed up the search to a level it's never reached before. I'm going to search even faster. This is the whole mentality of this area. You know, quite an interesting place to observe, right? Right in the center of the madness. Of course, we don't need any search at all. And it's not the question isn't how fast or slow is the search. They keep trying to disassociate the question and say, no, this is the question. They're trying to control what the question is. The question, there isn't any question, actually. We don't need to search. It's not a question. That's a statement of truth. There is no need for any search. There is no flaw with reality. So obviously we don't need to search for what doesn't exist. That's just insanity. It's whimsicality. If you want to search, knock yourself out. But there's no need for it at all. And so the questions about, well, how fast are we, are slow, you know, it's a meaningless question. You know, how can I enhance my search? How can I make my search better? How can I make it more successful? It's a meaningless question. It's a crazy question. The search can never be successful. It's inherently unsuccessful. So it doesn't matter. Those questions about how fast we're searching are meaningless questions. Every question the ego asks is a meaningless question, actually. Because it's based on the fundamental premise that there is a flaw. And it's just, we just have to find it. And it's based on the premise that somehow we were created to find that flaw. That's a total lie. You know, the lie is that the ego says that God specifically created us, or we've evolved. It says that too. We've specifically evolved as problem solvers, as that which is able to discover the underlying, the fundamental flaw of reality. And so, to not do so is to essentially lose our identity. See, if we take this false premise to be true, we think then that is our identity. And if we give up the search, we feel we're essentially giving up our identity. We have no identity. So we only think of ourselves as problem solvers. That's the only identity we think of ourselves, right? So of course, when we see there's no problem, so there's no problem, I'm not a problem solver. Then we think, oh my gosh, well, what's my identity? I don't have an identity. Now, my identity is that which is aware of reality. That's my identity. I'm a realist. That's my identity. And of course, the problem-solving aspect screams, that's no identity at all. What are you talking about? God didn't create that identity. And so, yes, God did. God didn't create the identity of a searcher, seeker for a problem. That's what God didn't create. They say, what are you talking about? Are you trying to rob me of my identity? And that, then the continuity fear comes up. All right? So the spiritual path is for those who are very willing, okay, very willing to be patient and understand what's going on. Recognize, okay, I have this continuity problem where I've been believing in a false identity. It doesn't even exist. There's no ground for it at all. So I need to now manage this transition, a successful transition to recognizing my true identity. The only one that there is I am the flawlessness. I am the all is this flawlessness. That's our identity, the identity. But the belief in a flaw doesn't understand that at all, can never understand it. So our identity is not one of being an understander. It's the ego that says, I need to understand what my identity, I need to understand, because it's feeling this futility. It thinks that my identity now, I can't find a flaw. It says, my flaw then is to fail and to be futile. So I need to understand, futility. No, we don't need to understand futility. We don't need to understand futility. We already have a perfect identity. We don't need to understand futility. We're not searching. We're not searching. Now, there was some commotion out there in the street. So I did. I just talked over it. Ignored it and just talked over it. I don't know exactly what it was about, because I was just focused on continued taping here. But it was some, very much anger from some searchers who were frustrated over their futility and projecting it on one another and arguing about it. So there's nothing to understand. It's not like the ego has to understand why there's no problem. It's not like we keep the ego. The ego says, okay, I understand why there's no flaw. I need to have this understanding. Without this understanding, there will be a problem. If I don't have the understanding of why there is no flaw, then there's going to be a flaw. As if the ego's understanding of why there's no flaw is keeping the flaw from happening. Okay, this is ridiculous, but we need to talk about it. It's like, aha, whoa. Now I see that. Aha. How are we doing here? Pretty good. Okay. So we're into this ringing our bell again, isn't it? Oh my gosh. The ego says, I need to understand why there's no flaw. If I don't understand it, there will be a flaw. I'll have a flaw. As if the ego thinks it's some part of reality. As if the search for reality is some part of reality, that if it's not successful, there's a flaw with reality. Imagine the craziness of this. If we don't successfully find the flaw of reality, that means reality has a flaw because we've been unsuccessful in our efforts. And that's a flaw. So the ego says, well, I have to understand, why did I fail? Otherwise, this is definitely a flaw in reality. My failure is a flaw. My failure is not, it's a whim. See, God doesn't mandate anything. So there can't be any failure. There's no such thing as failure in reality. Reality is failure free. It's impossible to introduce failure in reality. So it's not like we need to defeat failure. There isn't any failure. It's not like we need to understand why, how it is there's no failure. There isn't any failure. It's impossible. Because it's like everything's in pure spaciousness. Nothing can fail to be in pure spaciousness. Nothing can fail to abide in pure spaciousness. Impossible. There's no possibility of it. So there's no... We don't need to understand failure. or understand why we've avoided failure, there's no failure to avoid. There isn't any failure to avoid. So the ego can't be successful, doesn't need to be successful. Our whims don't need to succeed. It's impossible to fail. When we say, well, I failed to find the flaw in reality. that's a different level. That's confusion on it's a level of confusion, right? There isn't any flaw in reality, so how can you fail to find a flaw that doesn't exist? That's meaningless. That's literally using meaningless words in a meaningless way, in a whimsical way, actually, very whimsical. So whimsy is just whimsy. That's all you need to say about it. There's nothing to understand about it. It's just whimsy. Saying that a failure to find a failure with reality is a failure of reality, that's just whimsy. So we can realize, okay, that as soon as we don't laugh at the whimsy of that, then we're insane. Basically, we go insane. I mean, we're entertaining into whimsicality. And then we're trapped in this whimsicality, taking it serious. There's nothing to take serious about reality. It's impossible. There's no such thing as failure. We're always experiencing whatever it is we want to experience. We're complete sovereigns. And there's nothing amiss whatsoever. Everything's already perfect. It's totally perfect, flawless. So when we go about our day after this video, our evening, whenever, our time, and we may forget all about this and our clarity disappears and say, what happened? Oh my gosh, before I was ringing this bell, it was so clear, and now I don't have any clarity. Well, our attention has gone back onto the search is what's happened. And we're taking whimsicality seriously. And we're thinking, I need to succeed. I have to have some success. Since failure is impossible, there's no concept of success with reality. There's no concept. It's just isness. It's just isness. Reality is isness. There's no concepts. There's no duality in reality. There's not the duality of failure and success, of being and non-being. There's no duality with reality. It is. There's no possibility that it can be otherwise. So it just is. It's not succeeding at isness. It just is. So there isn't the feeling of success. It's the feeling of bliss. Bliss is a non-dualistic feeling. So what we're going to experience is a non-dualistic feeling. Somebody there. Okay. And we'll say, oh, well, I don't have the feeling of success. I need the feeling of success. Now, a feeling of success is part of a dualistic feeling of success and failure. It's based on the notion that failure is possible, which is based on the whimsical notion that failure to find failure with reality is a failure of reality. That's, okay, the fundamental formula of whimsicality. Failure to find failure with reality, or failure to find a flaw with reality, is a flaw, a failure of reality. That's whimsicality. And then when we feel the bliss of the one unified field, the oneness, we say, wait a minute, where's the success? Well, failure and success are this dualistic fear, basically. And we say, well, it's not there. That's a flaw. It's a flaw. No, there's no flaw. Failure to find a flaw in reality is not a flaw. Where's the one that is failing to find a flaw? It just isn't there. How can you fail to find it? It's not there. You see, the idea of failure to find it, means there's something there and you're failing to find it. But there isn't any flaw, so you... You can't speak of failing to find a flaw. That's ridiculous. It's whimsical. Okay, so again, we're just putting, adding our treasure to the side of the scale here, which we've been doing a lot of, and you know, so what you say, when's it going to tip? Well, we'll keep adding on until it tips. So everyone's pursuing success, the feeling of success, which is a dualism. It's based on the belief that failure is possible, which is false, which is whimsical. Which is really, whim is based on a desire to be greater than God. That's how our mind seizes upon whimsicality in order to try and be greater than God. That's the why of it. So again, when we tip our attention and see the total unified field, the vision of oneness, and then we feel this feeling of peace or bliss beyond understanding, beyond dualism. It's not dualistic. There's no way you can fall from it. It's impossible to fall. It's like I had that dream where I went up a ladder into this land where it was impossible to fall down. You couldn't fall. This means a land of bliss. This is the vision of oneness. You can't fall into failure there. Whereas success, you can always fall into failure, right? Whereas in bliss, there's nowhere you can't fall. And so like wow, this is weird. You know, okay, I can't fall at all. And now we're, you know, bringing to light why this is so. There isn't any failure to fall into. Failure to find failure is not failure. There's no category of failure in reality at all. You can always have, you always have exactly what you want. So it's impossible for there to be this notion of failure. It cannot exist at all. And failure to find what can never exist, it can't be seen as a failure. Because what does it deprive you of? Nothing at all. You're never deprived. So there can never be a real feeling of failure. It's impossible. What it really is fear, which is not a real feeling at all. It's a whim. It's a desire to be greater than God. It's a misperception. So we're right here. We're just looking together, walking together in the wow, is how I put it. We're just walking together in the wow here. And Krishnamurti would say, can we just look together at this? Just look together at this. Well, I'm saying, let us just walk together in the wow here. Now, the role of like Krishnamurti would just be to facilitate, you know, looking, you know, and then people say, oh, wow, Krishnamurti says, how about putting our attention here? Can you put your attention here? All right. Well, yeah. And what's being said here is let's look at this. Let's put our attention here. And then, wow. So let us experience this wow and this whole walking together in the wow as we assert, wow, flip the script and do this. So I already know that failure is impossible. I already know that failure is impossible. I already know that failure doesn't exist. I already know there's no such thing as failure. I already know there's no such thing as success either. There's no success, there's no failure. I already know there's no such feeling as success or failure. When we think we're feeling success or failure, really we're just denying feeling altogether, just denial of it. We're searching for a flaw in feeling. Feeling is bliss. That's the only thing there really is. call it love, call it bliss, call it peace. It's non-dual, absolutely non-dual. Reality is inherently non-dual. Again, duality is just a search for a flaw in reality, and there is no flaw. And we're anticipating that we'll find it. So this is why we imagine all these states of failure and success. Those are just imaginary. Now, the seekers for success, which is endemic in this world, Silicon Valley is an example. I mean, they push their kids towards success just relentlessly, thinking that they're doing them a great favor. Says, we got to eradicate, you know, any tendencies you might have to not succeed. And the kids, having, of course, some spiritual awareness coming into the world, we tend to have some. Saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, something's wrong, I don't know what. And they have nervous breakdowns, they get suicidal, they get on antidepressants, medication, all that kind of stuff. They turn to drugs, to, you know, at the weekends when their parents are gone or whatever, they sneak around, use drugs to try to just, you know, how can I get away from this horrible, relentless brain-mind search, you know, that's demanding success, success, success. And they say, I just want, you know, I just feel that this is just engulfing me, some kind of monster. And the parents don't understand at all. They say, what do you mean? I'm just trying to help you be successful. I'm just trying to do everything I can to help you be successful. Why are you upset with me? I don't get it. Oh my gosh, you know. And then they go psychiatrist, psychologist, therapy. And the therapist says, well, you know, you just need to adjust to, you know, you just need to realize and adjust to do the best you can to adjust and find the success that you're meant to find. And the parents really just are trying to do the best for you, and you need to try to not get too angry, and don't trap your anger. What they basically say is, you know, manage your anger here. Let's not, you know. They don't really say, well, you know, most of them, you know, the whole search for success is the problem, actually. They don't say that. Some of them might. If they're a good therapist, they will. They might say, well, maybe you just need to find what you're happy at succeeding at, you know, and get you into that, and then you won't be so angry. Yeah. So there's a lot of questionable therapy going on in the world, actually. And of course, many of them say, well, don't worry, you know, that we understand that you have just a chemical imbalance in your brain is the problem. So we'll tweak the chemical imbalance in your brain. Just take these medications and then you'll be fine. You'll be fine, don't worry. It's just some sort of genetic problem that you have, actually. Don't worry, this will fix it. Yeah, you might need to be on antidepressants for the rest of your life, you know. But we're actually working on genetic mapping and neuromapping, all this stuff, and we'll probably, you know, we're very optimistic. Very soon, we'll be able to treat this successfully, so you won't even need the medications. We'll just do some nanogenetic robotic surgery on you and fix your genes. And of course, doctors always say, you know, well, yeah, you know, you got this problem, but we're just about, almost have a cure for it. Now, the therapists think that, you know, they're doing God's work. And so if there is a God, God will certainly talk to them first, you know, say, hey, hi, I'm God, and you're doing a great job. I just want to tell you, you're doing a great job, and you're really helping everybody adapt and thrive in their search and be successful, and I just want to commend you and tell you that you're going to get a wonderful place after you die. And so that's what they expect. And then if God talks to someone else, communicates to someone else and says, hey, you know, this is what's really going on, and can you help share this with the world? They say, you know, how come they didn't talk with me? And what are you talking about? You're crazy. Where's your degree? Where's your degree? Well, I mean, I got to, you know, have a degree in God, you know, that's the degree. You could say that. I have a degree in God gave me. Who gave you the degree? God gave me the degree. Now you're crazy. I got my degree from Harvard or something. I have a degree in psychiatry from Harvard. What do you don't know anything. I said, well, you don't listen to God. You're pretty much, you know, listening to whimsicality. And that doesn't really know the answer at all. So how, you know, how are you really helping people? Now, you know, there's some help in sharing your problems with, you know, someone else. But it doesn't solve the, you know, problem. It can ease. It can help a little bit. I never found much help in therapy at all, actually. Didn't really do anything for me. Actually made me worse. Because I was frustrated. I said, you guys don't know what you're talking about. Well, I'm spending all this money and all this time and effort, and you're clueless. You don't know what's wrong with me at all. You don't have a clue. And this is why I was aware of this. I thought I was so wrong. How can you be so bad? You know, I was thinking there's a part of me that's rebellious. They tell you, well, you'll get over, as you grow up, you'll get over your rebellion, you know, and you'll understand our wisdom and stuff. And I said, well, I never did, you know. Now this rebellious part of me turns out to be the part that's oriented towards sanity and reality. And it was just telling me, hey, you know, don't go down that road. They don't know what they're talking about. They're still caught in the illogic of whimsicality, which is based on the desire to be greater than God. They have a severe continuity fear, and they don't know how to meditate successfully, and or, you know, pray successfully. The three-part practice. They don't know how to spiritually reorient successfully. They don't know how to normalize successfully. So they don't have the tools, so they're really incompetent. Doesn't make them bad. They're just incompetent, actually. So, okay. And then they say, well, take these drugs. That'll show you who's competent. And those make you feel, some, for me, it made me feel even worse, way worse. I said, wow, that's not the answer. What are you guys, crazy? My problem is nobody's listening to me. Yeah, you know, I went to the therapist thinking they would listen to me. I could explain to them what truth is, and they'd say, "Oh yeah, I understand that." I thought I'd find someone that would say, "Yeah, you're right." No. They didn't understand at all. My therapist actually became A Course in Miracles. I said, "Well, whoever wrote this, you know, understands. Maybe if I talk with them, they would understand." Only there's a lot of words there, you know, and that makes it seem confusing. Now, you know, I just feel like getting this out, you know, to the world is helping me out, because there's some that understand. And I feel that the teachers of God, they understand this. So we all have this rebellious, so-called rebellious part aspect of us. And when you're here, someone else understands it and says, no, that's the sane part of you, actually. Then you're just like, oh my gosh. You know, and then you start having hope. When I came across A Course in Miracles, I realized that somebody understood that this so-called rebellious part of me was actually the sane part of me. Okay? And then when that happened, I said, I know I'm going to get free of this misery and insanity. I know I'm going to get free of it. Just follow this wisdom within that knows the truth. It's rebelling against insanity is what it's rebelling against. That's a good and proper rebellion. It's not really rebelling. It's just gently saying, hey, you know, shift your attention over here and you'll see the truth. we have the wisdom within us, called the Holy Spirit, grace of God. It's within us. It just says, hey, just shift your attention off of the search, and then you won't need any words at that point. You won't need words. You know, and you just tell others, hey, just shift your attention off. That's all. Just shift your attention off of the search. Call off the search really means shift your attention off the search, and keep it off the search. Don't put it right back on the search and say, oh, I need to feel, now I can feel successful. No, just feel the peace and the bliss of the oneness. This is what we're told. I believe it. Absolutely believe it. It's all reasonable now. You see, the teachings of the great ones are becoming, you know, more and more reasonable. Where are we at now? We're moving along here. Oh yeah, pretty good. Pretty good. You know, why stop when you're on a roll? When you're on a roll, you know, eat the whole bowl of ice cream. I don't see too many people not eat the bowl of ice cream. They find a way to finish, don't they? So let us not underestimate the wow. This we got into areas that are deeper than ever, actually, and this is, you know, for sure has produced a tremendous wow for those who have ears to hear and recognize what's being said here. It's just wow. This is great news. It's almost unbearably great news. And so what we do is we just feel normalize it. Just sit, get used to it. So this is just normal. Yeah, I don't need to go back over as I say, yeah, this is normal for me. This is how I believe. This is how I think. This is how I look at it. This is where my attention is. This is normal for me, for my attention to be here. No problem at all. Just get used to that. This is normal for my attention to be here. It's normal. But don't try to explain it to your therapist, okay? See, the problem is I was trying to give therapy to the therapist, but the roles were not clearly delineated. So I should have said, I'm the therapist, you know, here. You're the patient, actually. And they got flipped on me here in this world. I was actually the therapist, and the patients flipped the role and said, no, you're the patient. You're the patient, and we're the therapist. And we're helping you adjust to the search, which is necessary, a necessary search. In fact, it's our identity. I said, no, hold up on the car wash there, you know, come on. You're not really the therapist, actually. It's kind of like, you know, in an insane asylum, there are those who take on roles. A lot of them have roles, and it's not uncommon for those who are in a state asylum. I'm not putting anyone down, absolutely not. But I'm just saying that this is a way of looking at it. Is they take on the role of being the therapist, you know. They study the therapist, and then they act like they're the therapist, and then they try to flip the script like that, okay, without getting into level confusion here of what I said previously. So if you truly are a true therapist, then certainly in this insane asylum we call this planet, it's a rehabilitation center actually, there are those who are pretending to be therapists who will try to flip the script on you and say that they're the therapist and you're the patient. And then you become, if they're able to do that, you then feel that the part of you that knows truth is rebellious and is great, ultimately crazy, and needs to be sublimated and repressed and dissected and gotten rid of, you know, and medicated, actually. That's what happens. Absolutely, that's what happens. If Jesus tried to teach, you know, the world, they would try to flip the script on him for sure and say, wow, we need some, you need some heavy medication, a lot of therapy. You're really ill, not adjusted properly to the search here. What's the matter with you? They say, no, don't worry, it's all genetic. We got it figured out. We're working on it. So just let's just put you in a coma. And when we get the genetic remedy, we'll wake you up from the coma. We'll do the genetic surgery, and then we'll wake you up from the coma, and you'll feel fine. You'll be well adjusted at that point. This world's like a rehabilitation center, actually. It's a spiritual reorientation center is what this world is. And of course, those who come here are either therapists or those who are in dire need of spiritual reorientation. In dire need of spiritual reorientation therapy. Spiritual reorientation therapy. SRT. Spiritual reorientation therapy. That's what we're doing here. That's all we're doing. Spiritual reorientation therapy. And it's great. I mean, it's fun, right? It's fun. Absolutely. You don't want to miss that. If you miss that, you miss the whole point of this world. And, you know, it doesn't matter how much sex, drugs, and rock and roll you indulge in. You're going to feel like, I really miss something. I'm missing something. Wow. You know, more sex, more drugs, more rock and roll. I need to double down. I'm missing something. What am I missing? You're missing SRT. You're missing spiritual reorientation therapy is what you're missing. What they are missing. I'm just speaking, you know, you. I'm just you, in a general sense, of course, to those that it applies to. You're missing spiritual reorientation therapy. Wow. Don't want to miss that. That's wait, just wasted your time here. Wasted your time. You're going to get a return ticket. How many return tickets do you want? So we're happy for the spiritual reorientation therapy. I'm absolutely grateful to the ultimate, to those who have, those spiritual therapists who have come here and helped out with that here and clued us into it and are still helping us. So we get to, you know, engage in the spiritual reorientation therapy, normalizing back to normalcy. Dropping the search, getting our attention off the search, that's what it's all about. So the wow is so strong. It's tough to proceed, actually. I feel like the wheels coming. If I start to try to proceed, I feel like the wheels are going to come off. And yeah, this is a feeling I get. I can see. My mind is kind of like trying to get a little bit frantic and say, let's look at this. I say, whoa, no, slow down. That's running around the town trying to hear where the bell is reverberating. You know, just sit quietly here. So yeah, I already know I don't need to successfully have a successful search. I don't need to search. I already know I don't need to search. I already know I was created with no need to search. I already know I have no intrinsic need to search. I already know I have no intrinsic need to find. I already know I've already called off the search. I already know I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I already know I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This is the repetition of certitude that I use during the day constantly, whenever possible. Just keep it going. Keep the fire going like that. It keeps the fire from going out, essentially. This is a practice that the Hindus sometimes use, is the sacred fire, the Veda. It comes from the Vedas of always keeping the fire burning. It's symbolic of practice. Always keep your practice going. Don't let it go out. In fact, Roman religion also was based on that. The Vestal Virgins, their whole purpose of their office was to make sure that the fires always kept burning. Never let the fire go out. If the fire went out, they would be severely punished for that. The fire there represented various things that represent in Roman religion. In the Vedas, it may have represented something else, but it's a symbol, meaning we can use it as a symbol. Don't let the fire of your spiritual practice go out. This is what it's really best used as a metaphor for. So we can do that by having one certainty of practice. Say, I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay? In other words, God didn't create me as a body to search for a flaw. No. God created me. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I mean, I'm absolutely free. I'm not bound by any search at all. How could we say we're absolutely free if we're bound by having to search and find something? That's not freedom. Having to find something's not freedom. Absolute freedom? No, it's not. So, as the original first recipient of the transmission of Ati Yoga or Dzogchen, Garab Dorje received it very simple, saying, you know, have one certainty, and stick to that one certainty. You know, and then shift your attention to non-dual and then abide in that. It's very simple. So the one certainty means, at least we can interpret it like, at least have some assertion that you're always saying it, you know, even when you're not doing this more profound focus. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I keep that going all the time. I try to keep it going all the time. Sometimes I forget, but then I just start again. If I'm going to take a rest, I lie down. I'm just saying it. If I wake up, I say it. I maybe go back to sleep. I just keep doing it. And then when I'm driving, I try to say that. Keep the fire going. Don't let it go out. Because if it goes out, it's hard to start it again, right? The idea of needing to keep this fire going. Now, hummingbird, where is it? Oh, it's right there. Okay, right here, right in front of me. Wow, drinking from the bird of paradise. Cool. There's wings catching the sunset there. Wow, very, very beautiful, symbolic there. Wow. Taking a drink out of, you know, from paradise, taking a drink from knowledge, taking a drink from, you know, attention on the unified field, on the oneness. What unified field? The oneness of spaciousness and appearance and awareness of all of it. It's all one. The Trinity is one. It's all one. It's unified. It's a unified Trinity. The spaciousness, the display, and the awareness. God, three aspects in one. God is one. with three aspects in one. There's not really three gods. There's one God. There's one God with this unified three aspectness of it. The spaciousness, the display, it's like the sun. They use it like the sun. There's the spaciousness where the sun is, the sunlight. The sunlight is in the spaciousness. And then there's the light of the sun, right? And then the awareness of that too. It's all one, isn't it? There's not seams there. There aren't any seams. So the vision of seamlessness, the vision of seamlessness, the vision of oneness, this is what we are going for. How are we doing here on the time? Oh, we're doing okay. And it ultimately, it's the gigabytes. It kicks off at 4 gigabytes exactly. It stops. I haven't been finding a way to override that. Discipline. There's an itch there. Feel an itch. Scratch. No, don't scratch. Don't scratch. Keep hands to hands. That's it. Hands to hands. So again, this intense wow. I already know that there is no flaw. I already know there. I don't have. I'm not in. There's nothing I need to intrinsically find. I'm free. I already know. I'm intrinsically free of any need to find anything. I already know I'm intrinsically free of any need to find anything. Reality is search free. I already know that reality is search free. So can reality be found? Okay, this is the final question, isn't it? I think we trip up on that and say, oh my gosh, I stumbled on that. No, let's not stumble. They say, no, it can only be revealed. It's only revealed when you give up your desire to find anything. And the ego will say, well, you're experiencing reality. Well, I want to find it too. You know, you found it. What if I didn't find it? No. It's always been here. You can't say that it's found. Finding implies that it implies to a flaw, right? It has to. Because if omnipresence, you can't say that you can find omnipresence. So you can never find reality. Finding is entirely an egoic concept. And the ego will then say, well, it's meaningless then. It has no meaning. No, it's finding that has no meaning. It's the ego that has no meaning. It's searching that has no meaning. Reality doesn't need meaning. Reality doesn't need any meaning. It is. The isness it is. There's no opposite to reality. So why does reality doesn't have to establish meaning? It is. We're We're just letting the sun set here. It's like, what is this, April 2nd? Wow, it already feels like there's so much light and warmth and light and everything here. Doesn't get dark till, I mean, what, it's 7:30 or later than that now, actually. Almost 8. Wow. Of course, the spring solstice was, what, March 20th? So we're only, like, about 12 days past that. We're going towards more light all the time. That's great. The ego will tell us, well, you're not successful with your practice spiritual reorientation because you're not talking about it right now. You're talking about the weather or something. No, we're just cooling down in the wow here a little bit because we've been so successful. We're like, stunned. Very stunning video for me, that is for sure. Because why? Wow, because my attention is on this, easily on this, all this. That's a very good sign. If you can put your attention on this just like that, just like that, and just sit down, even if you're tired, exhausted, and just okay, and your attention easily just rests upon all of this, then that is a very positive indication. Do I have my phone? No, I don't. Good. That's one way to beat the whole situation. Just don't have your phone with you. All right? People say, I called you. How come you didn't answer your phone? I say, oh, I forgot. Okay. People will definitely try to distract you if you're hooked into that whole thing. Absolutely, they will. Are you kidding? They think they're doing you a favor. Absolutely, they're saying, "Wow, we're getting your attention back on the search. You're slacking. You don't be a slacker, do you? You don't have a smartphone. What kind of slacker are you anyway?" I said, "Actually, the Holy Spirit's indicated that minimizing your involvement with." Artificial intelligence is a very smart thing to do. I don't have to completely knock it off, but minimize it. Minimize. Limit your exposure to artificial intelligence. They'll think you're a slacker. What's wrong with you? That's what I get. People say, wow, you're some kind of slacker in life, huh? No, I'm a therapist, actually. I'm not a slacker. I'm a therapist. Spiritual reorientation therapist is what I do. And don't slack at that at all. Working on that, constantly. No slacker here. I hope Jesus doesn't see me as a slacker. I guess it's always possible, you can say, well, you could do more, but, this is quite a bit of work as it is. But I'll keep working. I'll do something even more. P- put your attention, again, your attention, 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 attention. Your attention is your treasure, okay? Your treasure. So guard your treasure against bank robbers, okay? There's a lot of bank robbers out there who want to distract your attention, who want to tweet your attention away, okay? Don't let them tweet your attention away. I'm on Twitter, I don't have any friends. Same with Facebook. Okay, anyone in Rome, do as Rome do. You need a Facebook account, you need a Twitter account. Okay, great. But there's no interaction. I never go to even check. Those can be great distractors, that is for sure. It's kind of a way of the defense systems know how to incorporate whatever aspirations you have for dropping the search by ersatzness. That's a nice word. I hadn't heard that in a long while until some baseball sports agent used the term ersatz baseball. You know, I said, hey. Let's revive that word, ersatz. Very good. They had this rookie had a great showing in spring training, and the Chicago Cubs sent him down. He said, "Well, you know, you need a little more seasoning." And they said, "No, you're just trying to. It's just a contract thing. You're trying to get an extra year out of him." Yeah, maybe. Sure, that's part of it. But actually, probably did need some extra seasoning. They said, you need to play left field. But he's never played left field before. How are you going to start him in major leagues and they never played the position? That's nuts. It's going to affect their overall confidence, for sure. So they sent him down. And the agent said, that's ersatz baseball. You're not having the best players in baseball. But I would say it's like full stop in the wow. He proved to himself, hey, I really can succeed up here as a hitter. And then, you know what? Let him just... full stop in that wow of that. I mean, let that settle into him. Don't rush him. Don't rush him. I find so many players get harmed mentally by being rushed up. There's only a few that can handle getting thrown into the fire. A lot of them, it damages them. They press. They try too hard. They get frustrated. They lose confidence. So here, we have great success. We say, we can do it. And then we say, okay, we can do it. Now, let's just get used to that fact. And maybe go back to the minor leagues for a few days, that kind of thing. Don't let it hurt your pride. Full stop. We realize, wow, okay, I just put my attention on what's really important. Tremendous, okay? Let's just kind of now rest in that and not try to... you know, forge ahead and say, okay, I'm here to stay. I'm a big leaguer. I'm great. You know, no, we're not there yet. Focus on one thing, shift your attention, have no doubts about that this is it, and then stay there. You know, very basic instructions that apply. Sun is setting and we're cruising along here. Absolutely. Gonna shift over here. Shift the attention here. Shift of attention. So a lot of information here, and the main thing is that you got your attention onto it, okay? You get your attention onto it, and then you realize, I can do this, it's like swimming. The more you swim, the more you realize you can do it. And I used to be a swimmer, loved to swim, and I just swam so much, I got really good at swimming, I could really swim. I felt very confident. So much so I could be out in a storming ocean and just say, you know, I'm not scared. I can float, I can tread water, I can, you know, get to where I want to go. Got used to the ocean, diving under waves, body surfing, did a lot of body surfing. probably should have done more boogie boarding. Have a you know board there or something. But just swim and just body surf, catch the wave swimming. That's pretty fun and pretty intense actually. Here comes the wave. You're just swimming. That's it. I didn't even have fins. You know, I'm just swimming and you can catch it and just go down and just get crunched. A lot of times it was really intense. Hit the bottom. I got hit the bottom of the sand once so hard that later on the skin in my face peeled off. It's unbelievable what happened. That kind of stuff is for the young. I said, wow, but that's cool. I just got pounded. My face got pounded into the bottom of the ocean. That's cool. Wow, I've never done that before. So we're cooling down a little bit here. This video's been very intense. I understand that, you see. That's why I just small talk it a little bit and cool down a bit here. This was maxed out on the intensity, actually. Just the scope that we covered here, you know, it's just so intense. So I'm just enjoying the play of light here on the background. You know, right now it's the sun is just about ready to slip below a mountain, and this is kind of cool to see this. So we get the clarity, the spiritual reorientation practice, and a light show at the same time here. That's great. That's wow. A lot of wow there. It's almost gone. The sun is almost gone, and this you'll see on the background. So don't follow the news too much, okay? We got the answer here. We have the practice here, getting our attention to where it needs to be. Ultimately, we need to shift our attention off of the search, right? And so we're looking very carefully at how to do that and the ramifications and the objections the ego is raising and recognizing how silly they are and not taking it seriously, laughing at it. And this is what has to be done. And this background here is about ready to fade away. I wonder what will happen. It'll probably the background just darken up like this background you see here over there. That's already dark. The spiritual reorientation is fun, a lot of fun. It's very intense. It's even more intense than body surfing, I'll tell you that. Way more intense. It's like spiritual body surfing, actually. There you go. Here comes the fade. Nice. Now, it was a Rorschach test. What do you see in those patterns of light there? Yeah. Somebody say, I see an ohm there, you know, or something. Possibly, you know, I don't know what I see there. trying to sneeze here. Excuse me. Just suppressed it. Great. Wow, that was cool. So we have a ink blot, a light blot test here. Light blot test. What are you seeing? I see the clear light. I see the non-dual reality there. I can see. That's right. Wow, very nice. a fade out. Awesome. You even get the shadows playing there. Nice. Tree branches moving, giving little shadows there. Oh, look at this beautiful fade out. The sun is still a little sun there, absolutely. A very nice cool down. Now, of course, the going through an intense practice like orientation practice like this is you feel, you're going to feel, you know, that wow, you just got your bell rung for sure. Absolutely. We're just taking the edge off of it here. So we're not going to press any more information here. This is the cool down towards the end of the video, and we are getting close to that right now, actually. Kind of like a perfect fade out. I don't know when I started, but it's like an ideal time. I can backtrack it. It's 2:27, 7:09. I don't know how to do the math on that, but I'll figure it out. It's a good time to start because we get this natural cool down here of the sunset. Wow, that's great. O'clock would be 2 hours, 7:09. So 5:09 would be 2 hours. We have the 27. So 5:09 would be 2 hours. 5 o'clock would be 2 hours and 9 minutes. 4:42 would probably be it then, right? Because that's 18 and 9 is 27, so 4:42. So maybe tomorrow I'll start at 4:44. How about that? Start at 4:44, and you get this perfect cool down. That's very symbolic. Awesome. Awesome cool down. We're getting pretty close here. A few more megabytes to go. Just enjoy the cool down here. No need to think, you know, no need to think, no need to succeed, find, search, no need to succeed. It's okay, you just keep in mind, you're able to put your attention onto this. That is the key. Can't keep it on it all the time yet, okay, but this eventually we'll shift our attention. The scales will, like that, they'll tip. That's why practice is necessary. Okay, we're cruising towards the end of it here. Great job, absolutely. Remember, don't worry about You don't think I need a feeling of success. Stay in the wow. Stay in the wow. That avoids the failure success duality, and the wow will eventually lead us to bliss. Okay. We will see you next time as this gets closer and closer and closer to the magical 4 gigabyte limit. And the sun is just about, it's pretty much gone now. Yeah. All right. Very great.